right. Welcome, everyone. It's really a great pleasure to welcome Li Hu this evening. Li Hu is certainly no stranger to the school. For 5 years, he led Studio X Beijing, creating one of the first architecture and design hub in the city, a platform he successfully engaged to think about the future of Beijing almost live, as it was going through some of its most extreme and rapid transformations. Then he became too busy and way too big, with an increasingly interesting practice and highly visible commissions such as the recently completed Ocean Center at Tsinghua University, a building that takes the traditional campus quad and moves it up vertically to create a series of public spaces distributed in section for the meeting of minds. Or HEX-SYS, a reconfigurable, reusable, and quite elegant building system, which sits at the intersection of ancient Chinese wooden building systems and Le Corbusier's modular explorations, and proposes an alternative to the Chinese contemporary production frenzy, one that can be at once more flexible and more sustainable. Or the free-form new school for the prestigious Beijing No. 4 High School, conceptualized as an undulating new open ground which distributes a series of interwoven vertical gardens throughout the school that integrate inside and outside in an almost seamless way. These are just three wonderful examples of Li Hu's recent projects. And while they are three buildings operating at a building scale, they also clearly carry with them a unique consciousness of the city around, echoing the concerns Li Hu was bringing to the platform of Studio X. How to think and make architecture that is not only deeply embedded within its urban context, but produces new possibilities for this context. How to think through architecture about the city, its history, past scale and fabric, but also its future form, livability, and open and green space. And more importantly, how to think through architecture about life, about people, and about creating new relationships, new experiences, and new grounds for exchange. As the name of his practice suggests, Li Hu's research and work lie in redefining the open and public grounds that buildings not only sit on, but are anchored within, create around them, and then carry up through them, always weaving together the built and the natural at a time and in a place where rapid urbanization has created unprecedented challenges, but also new opportunities for engagement and for invention. These opportunities are ones that Li Hu's practice is shaping through intense collaboration across the disciplines of the built environment, something that we certainly find quite important here at the school. But even beyond that, it's also interesting to note that collaboration is the first mention in Li Hu's mission statement for the office, for the office with an image of his design team working, indeed representing an unmistakable commitment to the same exchange and openness that he seeks to design through his architecture and his buildings. Open was founded by Li Hu and Huang Wenjing in New York City before establishing Beijing as its home base in 2008. The practice has been widely recognized with recent honors, including the winning prize of World Architecture Awards for Chinese Architecture, the Best Architecture Award of China Architecture Media Awards, the World Award of Asia Pacific Interior Design Awards, amongst many other. They've also been invited to participate in international exhibitions such as the Venice Biennale and the inaugural Chicago Architecture Biennale. Li Hu received his B.Arc from Tsinghua University in Beijing in 1996 and an M.Arc from Rice University in 1998. He worked at Steven Holl Architects from 2000 to 2010 and became a partner of the firm in 2005. During his time with Steven, Li founded and led the firm's Beijing office and was responsible for the firm's influential projects in Asia, including the Linked Hybrid in Beijing, the Vanke Center in Shenzhen, Raffles City in Chengdu, and Sifang, and the Sifang Art Museum in Nanjing. Li left the partnership at Steven Holl Architects in 2011 to focus on his practice of open architecture. But tonight, we have this opportunity to reunite them both on stage with Steven giving the response to the lecture. But for now, please join me in welcoming Li Hu.
Um, Thanks, Dean Andrews, for a wonderful introduction. And again, thanks GSAPP for inviting me to be back here. Always feel like home, back to New York City. I often tell people that this is a city I actually grew up mentally and as architect. So I'm so happy to be back. Forgive my jet lag and my rusted English after living here, left the city for 10 years. Actually, exactly 10 years since I left. But I feel like I've never really left the city. And every time I come back here, I feel like coming home. So tonight, I'm very honored to be here to share with everyone through a stories of 8 projects we have done recently in the last few years. Except for one, all the other 7 under construction or finished construction. I begin with this slide. Where I like to see the world with no boundaries between countries, which is causing a lot of conflict these days. I select this 8 projects, and they are distributed, interestingly, now after I put them together, in 3 regions of China. You know, I rotated the map a little bit, so it's a little disoriented. But they happen to be the 3 major metropolis in China's being formed and also, you know, being planned. The region around Beijing, Shanghai on the Yangtze River, and the Pearl River Delta region. I begin with this sentence I wrote when I was asked to give a definition of architecture by this editor making the book called Book of Quotes. Architecture is both a medium to express our understanding, critique, and hope of the world around us, and a medium through which we can engage it with our best imagination, courage, persistence, and strategies. This is how I see architecture. And with that, our practice is deeply engaged with the observation of the society that is evolving around our life. I'm just going through this following few images and scale as something constantly changing its conception, you know, with the rapid urbanization and the conditions. And we are probably living in a time, perhaps the most dramatic of the human history, where you see a collapsing of time. The most current commercialism, and you know, the and people living, certain people living state of the mind, the feudalism, and it's simply no longer easy to distinguish the East and the West, or so meaningful to talk about the East and the West. And how do we see program today? This is one of the biggest buildings, supposedly biggest, the single mass of buildings in the world, in Chengdu. And our conventional knowledge and what we know, the notion about city, the nature, the village, the countryside, sometimes collapsed in reality. And we have to constantly question, what do we know really? And equally, the identity. And can the city provide the generosity where it's supposed to provide? And living in China, I feel like I'm living in the kind of daily drama where sometimes the unexpected, unimaginable happens in reality. You know, next to the one of the most expensive buildings in the city, you can also find the most affordable food. And borrow from one of the photograph from this very young documentary photographer, that is the greed driving all of us mad globally, not just in China. And among the buildings we've been, you know, built everywhere, and you know, something's missing at the same time. It's this nature, it's being displaced. And often we forgot about the future. And the speed we're moving, and sometimes is so fast that it's leaving our soul behind. And the urbanism or building without compassion, and what kind of personality is this shaping us into? And are we into too much into the image making, you know, architecture or the city is designed as a fantasy, and from what point of view? And what can we, how do we look at the power, you know, the public space, and today what's the concept of the public and the private? Is our freedom being pushed to the outskirts of the city, you know? Can architecture express the hope of the freedom? And what this bubble has left us with? Problems, opportunities, and things we have to face and reconsider and redesign and readapt to these things. And the air right, we're notorious that Beijing is probably most famous for the air quality. But what's interesting is the air quality is changing lots of the previous notions about how building works. In the past, we know cross ventilation is great for green architecture. But now, we have to reconsider sealed buildings for clean air. And above all, my most worry is actually in the status of humanity. Among all the commercialism, has our humanity improved, the human spirit, from 100 years ago or from 5,000 years ago? And can we, what can we do as architects? And these are the questions constantly evolving, coming to the mind among our work. I want to tell a short story about a bicycle. And something I noticed recently has been a really inspiring event. China's known in recent history that is, you know, it's the kingdom of bicycles, and that quickly disappears and replaced by automobiles. And in fact, that's how most cities, new cities are being planned for no longer pedestrian or walking, but or bicycles, but for cars. Until recently, only less than a year ago, these beautifully designed bikes start to show up on the street and increasing at astronomical speed. So this is a small kind of startup company called the Mobike. I'm also a user of Mobike. Although I have my own bikes. What's interesting is that now the mobikes everywhere in the city, and people who abandoned bicycles are start to return to using bikes again. And I was wondering if the failure of the city planning today contribute to the success of the bike, or in the other way around, the success of this bike would help to fix the problem of the city, because it helped to make the link, the last mile, what they call the last mile, for what the subway can now do. They link you from your home to the subway and the subway to your workplace. And it become extremely popular all of a sudden. Of course, its success also being helped by the new technology of the smartphone and the WeChat, all these amazing new tools coming out. You know, it's something the city has tried over the last 10 or more years on the public bike system, but never worked and always failed. But this company and many other following are making this way through and make it work because the technology make it really user-friendly and make you want to use it. And plus, it's a great design of the bike. So to wrap up that, the China bubble was blowing very large up to the Olympics, and everybody thought it going to burst. And I was ready for that. I thought it's a great, we can finally slow down to spend some more time thinking. And then it quickly continued to blow even bigger. So, and this continues of this pressure of the bubble. And I was quoted on this Mark magazine, probably lots of people hate it, that I said, we built too much too fast. That was in 2014. But the speed seems never really slows down, and I think that's probably more worrying happening. So I began the first project, A School is a City with a Farm and Gardens. And this is, in fact, our first project that a competition we won, and took us 4 years to design and build. I think it goes super fast in China, and the scale we're working with. Reflecting on this, I think the perhaps what helped to make it possible to make a design work is the way that it's not as established as other places in the world that allows a parallel design and construction. Otherwise, there would be no way to get anything done properly. This is the location of the school, and that's the center of the city. That's where our office is, and that's the airport, just to give a sense of location. Of course, as a young practice, independent practice, not a public institution, that we are always push on the edge of the city to work where there's no chance for us to get any commission in the city. Well, the school, China recently has been experiencing a boom of building schools. There's schools coming up everywhere. As a part of the new city being planned, you know, satellite cities and small towns being built around the countries, where school is something required as a part of the new developments. And equally here, this kind of Oscar outside the Fifth Ring Road in Beijing, this new town is built very rapidly. Like this is in the year of 2006. And you start to see things being changed at this 2010 is when we started to design the project on basically an empty abandoned farmland. And the 2014, when the project is near completion, you start to see the new city coming up. And now, so only 10 years time, he have a new city, and with probably, you know, I don't know, 100,000 residents, and also the price of the apartments went up probably 5 times over the last 10 years. And the school is important because it helps to bring people out of the city and to be able to move here. So it was also a time when we're doing the design that as a parent, I was looking for a school for my daughter, who was just about the age to enter elementary school. And It's also about the time, only a few years after we moved back to Beijing. And I was worried that this is the conventional school in China, probably same in many other countries. That's the physical environment. And they produce this kind of system that study and the test is a way to kind of to climb up this kind of social ladders, perhaps. It worries me deeply, and in the city environment, and the kids grow up, and they have very little opportunity to be engaged with nature. And so these were things, concerns and a beginning point of the idea of the school that, you know, working against all perhaps the most difficult regulations, building codes and high densities, what can we do to introduce gardens and maximize your interaction with gardens and to bring a piece of memory of the farm also. So we called it a garden school, that we put in the schools, the teaching activities in between the farm and the roof and the garden and the ground, where we, you know, putting some of the larger spaces like the gymnasiums, the canteens and auditoriums as the shape of the part of the landscape and kind of half buried on the ground to create this kind of multiple level of the ground levels. So that was the site, and that was the project from view. Well, the project really doesn't really have a special point of view to look at it, or has a clear image. But it's more about experiences we created from within. You know, the experience of the life living on this campus, where the possibilities to be able to study in the nature. And create kind of rich experiences. Luckily, the school really accept the concept of this farm on the roof, and the practice of farming become part of the curriculum. And they do this three seasons a year, and even produce the food for the canteen downstairs. So at the time the building opens and the welcomes the first group of students, and we decided to make a map. I was always thinking, you know, the little map in New York City of the subway map you can put in your pocket. So we designed this kind of tiny little foldable map for the students to get oriented. And then I thought about the school is really like a city, you know, it has its own streets and little plazas and different places. So this little map also shows the different components of the buildings that become part of the experience, a special experience working and studying in the school. The lobby that connects different spaces and different levels. And the details we have to kind of invent on the construction site. And the libraries, as a very special practice, the principal allows the parents to come to the school, because in the new town like this, there's essentially no public building, no public spaces, where the parents are actually very fascinated of spending time after work with their students. And the students prefer to stay in the school even after the school hours, because they feel it's more comfortable to be here. And the lecture hall over the pond. And recently we just converted it into a small theater. And again, you know, design workout again on the site, even after construction documents, and auditoriums, also double function the theater and with a theatrical garden above. Music rooms and the dance rooms. And dance teacher said this is the best place for her to dance. And gymnasium take advantage of the natural ventilation and the daylighting. This is space below and the space above. And it works very well to invert the concept of outdoor and indoor, the teaching. So a lot of teaching start to actually happen in the space outside. And in the polluted days, there's a lot of space for the kids to run inside. So the idea of that, these two things can actually switch back and forth. And there are 12 stairs in the building that I believe the stairs the one of the most important spaces that has kind of human scale. So every stair is designed in a different ways. And you know, the way that you can move freely in different ways up and down the building, luckily is kept by the school principal, who is very open to the idea. You know, if this is, of course, I forgot to mention, this is one of the most famous middle school in China, the number 4. If this is a different kind of school, perhaps they would lock all the doors up and leave just one door, as happened in most of the schools. So every time I go back to visit, I'm so happy to see they kept all the door open and not worry about the kids getting lost. And the bamboo gardens bring lights to different levels, even to the parking below. And the canteen, this is a very large canteen that allows 1,000 people to eat together. And also was the time the Avatar, the movie just opened, so I thought making this image of the floating island for the faculty to eat above and the students below. And in China, if you go to eat in Chinese restaurant, there's always a VIP, the VIP little small rooms. So we make this kind of igloo. Because when I was working on the design of the project, the principal sometimes invite me to have this kind of small room with them. And it was interesting that this become really a special place where, you know, the principal calls some special faculties or students come to eat with them and have special meetings. Of course, the fundamental teaching space, in the end, interestingly, become not even the most important space, because the teaching can really happen anywhere. But we still, you know, figure out a way to do the teaching in two different ways. You know, it's a room can be used in horizontally or vertically, and has a kind of openness to the space around it. And corridors like experience of like a street where people can share their books and their artworks. And as we left lots of open space for the school, and they start to, you know, use it for different things. And these islands that flows, you know, this little semi-private spaces provide a different kind of scale in these very large buildings, and takes on different things, you know, like space for the students to invent whatever they like to do. And as we're designing the building, it's very complex, very large. In fact, still up to now, the largest interior design project I ever did. And so there's always kind of corners you don't see on the plan till later on you discover, oh, there's a space there. So we invented, let's just do a rock climbing. And it took us months and months to convince the school to provide this extra budget to make this work. So, you know, there's always a kind of exciting accidents happening in the process of the construction. We just have to come up with new drawings and to make it work. And the principal of the school is a physics teacher, so that make the discussion a little easier to begin with. And he said, I want you to make the school like a textbook. So I thought the most important thing a building can do is to show the honesty, you know, to let the students to experience the simplicity and the truthfulness of the materials, you know, how things start to work together. And of course, as in all the practices we do in China, that with the speed we work with, it's very important to continue to work on the construction site and continue to work on the details. And a lot of these things are really, really, as I mentioned, happen in the construction phase. And the project is so large, every time I go to visit the construction site, it's an exhausting experience. You can't even finish walking, checking all the corners on one visit. So I was always, this is like me, burned out after one visit. So since we did this school, there's even a bigger boom of building schools. And what's interesting, because the school is very important in education in China, they organize this every year, a conference for school principals from all over China. And it's called a 1,000 principal meeting every year. So I'm very happy to see one thing this project has done to the rest of the future schools, that they set a new standard. Because previously, school is, like housing, sort of ignored by architects. Because, you know, you don't make much money out of it, and it's a lot of work involved. So it's done without so much design. But since then, all these principals have seen what school can be, and they start to talk to architects, finally. But we still turn down, you know, most of the commissions, because either it's too fast and the budget is too low to make it meaningful, or is it too dense, or the site is not appropriate. Until recently, we finally pick one commission. I want to do something completely different, because if the Beijing is about microform, borrowed from Professor Frampton's words, when we got the opportunity to do a school in a different climate in Shanghai, I'm going to try something just the opposite, to explode a school into pieces and to create a different kind of experience where we can put the architecture and the non-architecture, or the space in between them, equally important, and place them like throw the dice on the campus, and finding a balance between them and form a different, very different kind of campus experience. So this is the first commission we accepted after turned down most of the other opportunities. Next, I'm going to move east to the coast, where we had the opportunity to work on two smaller buildings, finally. The first one, a camp with a theater. So this project happens when we're working on the school, where in fact was recommended, referred by the principal, who is a friend of this organization who's starting to build the very first camp introduce the American camp education to the Chinese educational systems. They first work with the architect Kengo Kuma's office for 6 months, and they were not happy with the design, the things not working out, and they're running out of time. And for some reason, they must get the building done by July in 2012, and I was very suspicious if this is possible, given only 6 months' time to do a building, quite complex, from design to build, in only 6 months' time. And the deadline is not moving anywhere. It has to get it done. And so that's where the building sits in the city, this small town called Beidaihe. If you look at the Google Earth, this is one of the few places that didn't change much. And this is why. It began, it's just a little fishing village, but in the late 19th century, the Western missionaries start to discover this vacation place because, you know, it has a rarely beautiful beach in North China. But it was populated after Mao started to swim in the ocean, and it's where the central government set up, you know, places like the Camp David. It's where this leaders of the country spend their summer in the months of from late July to mid August, and that's precisely sets the deadline of mid July because no construction is allowed after mid-July, and they have to get it opened. So we're like rushing. We got basically 1 week time, and until one Saturday morning, I finished a sketch. I realized maybe this is the way to go. You know, it's a site has a 3 meters drop as on the sitting on a slope, and I have to come with some strategy to make it work. I know it's impossible to get the design finished in such a short time. So I thought, what if I just make a flat roof? So I began with a simple flat roof for two reasons. First, it maximized the playground spaces for these kids. And secondly, this allowed us to continue to work on the program underneath. So I make a roof. This building began with a roof. So it has the roof, and the shapes just come naturally from the site. Basically, you know, I draw a line around of the offset from the zoning regulations and around the corners, and so here we have a design. So, and come with the structure, and then later on we just start to develop the different programs around this courtyard. So it began with the courtyard and the flat roof. And the program continued to evolve. You know, at the beginning, I was proposing to have the basketball court, so, you know, part of the sports. And later on, become a theater, because then came in the operators that we run theaters, so let's make a theater. But in fact, it's a great thing, because in the whole Beidaihe, there's no theater. This will be the first theater. And then some of the room become a hotel, a little tiny little hotel for the faculty. So anyway, so that's a part of the life of the architects, that things constantly change. And it's a frustration, but also excitement. You know, sometimes it makes things better along the process. And this flat roof really works in the process of the construction, and you know, allows this at least a very comfortable temperature for the contractors, and it allows the interior work can go parallel with, you know, the curtain wall and everything around it. So I never believed that they can get the work done, but magically it happens. Literally, it took them 3 months to build the project from scratch. And the holds are very well, even up to today. Oh, by the way, and the year following, the institution was able to get Kenyahara to make the signage. You know, when the building first opened, there's no signage. There's no time for the signage. So one of the most important spaces of this project is this theater, and it become the a thing that can transform the buildings. So as we're working on the theater, I thought, what if the theater can opens and it bring in the choir into the space? You know, it's kind of swallows the choir, so the choir become part of the theater, and it changes and the position of the audience and, you know, the spectator and the performance in different ways. And this is at the evening of the opening night in July, July 16th, when the first door opened. And then the first layer open shows the second layer, which is actually the envelope of the theaters. It become the projection screen. As you can see, outdoor movies. When that layer opens up again, the theater and the courtyard connects. And they're really having fun of the space, taking advantage of the possibility of how to use the space. The other interesting thing is that at that summer, Beidaihe had the biggest storm in their recent histories. Even the new train station got completely flooded. So I was really nervous, and lots of people are coming for the openings, and right before the opening was a huge storm. And everyone's nervous because we made a lot of crazy design, because I insist the theater and the courtyard is flat, so you can use instead of making, you know, otherwise making a step of, you know, a foot differences. But it works out as everyone's watching very nervously if the rain gonna come into the theater. I didn't. And the drainage and we designed this kind of drainage along the path, along the slope, really works to bring the water away, goes underneath and out of the building. Also, you know, working with the industries, that this door of 6 meters tall, were rejected by most of the fabricators, said that's not possible. And until one day we found one place in Guangzhou, and they actually made it happen, you know, and it works very easily by a single person to move this thing open and close. So second project, in the same city, slightly south, when we're asked by this very interesting young entrepreneur who is the owner of this developer company, who experienced a very interesting, almost a accidental success story of making a library on the by the sea, who was designed by a friend of mine, but got famous overnight on the internet, you know, with the social media. So that bring a lot of success for his developments. And then he started to invite more architects to make what they call the pavilions, small architecture, as part of actually the communal space for this kind of holiday resort developments. And that's where the site is, you know, by the sea. This is the satellite map of 2008. You know, thanks Google, we can see the history, which we could never imagine in the past. And that's basically now. And that's where the little small library is. So he first came to us because he saw the camp project. He said, I want you to design a kindergarten. You know, camp, he thought it's part of the, similar to kindergarten. And I asked him, what else do you want to build? He said, maybe a museum. I said, okay, I'll do the museum. because I wanted to always do different things. She said, okay, let's try. So we started working in the museum. I questioned sometime, what's the relation of the building to the site, you know? If a building can be put on the sand by the sea, and it can also happen put it somewhere in the mountain, and what's the connection really here? So at the very beginning, I thought I want this building to have a deep connection to the site. At the site I chose, we discussed to where to place this this museum. Well, literally, museum is a, what's really a museum is a questionable. But he wanted basically a different kind of place to show art, where we can watch the sunrise having breakfast, and also being, you know, surrounded by art. So, you know, his idea is still being discussed. But anyway, what's special about the site is that there is a luckily preserved a natural sand dune. It's kept in this shape because there's a very special local species of trees that grows in the sand and help to maintain this shape, you know, to prevent the sand going to the other part of the city. That's this kind of sand dune. At the very beginning, I thought about what if we build something into the sand rather than destroy anything here or just place them randomly on the beach. In a way, maybe it can also help to keep the sand dune for the future, because most other part of the sand dune is already destroyed. And later on, I thought about what if we make a dialogue? There's another thing that is almost in the opposite position, that is in the ocean, and that is really deeply connected to the space here. So we make two museums instead of one, and then we split this program to two. So one part going to the ocean, and the idea that to create a kind of experience, a pilgrim almost, to see art instead of, you know, our common experience of how we see art today. And that with the tide rise and falls, then sometimes you can walk over, sometimes you cannot. So I begin first with the space in the sand, that that's the very special formation of the sand I just took recently in the winter. And some of the inspiration from, you know, the early discovery of art and how nature changed the, you know, the shape materials. So intuitively I thought, let's make a collection of spaces that, you know, that carve into the sand, and some for the art, some for other functions. And that was the beginning of the concept. And we start to work on the possibilities of this, how this can work. And these are some of the early models we built. And the interesting potential of bringing light into the space, and the kind of mysteries of spatial qualities. And start to invent the programs and how they work with different spaces. So this perhaps the one of the smaller projects we did, if not the smallest, but it took us a long time to develop. We've been working on this project for almost 2 years by now. And that's a view from the roof. How different kind of cells and bubbles and start to be independent, also working together, and they merge sometimes. And we built this model to show how the structure works, this kind of thin shell concrete structures. Of course, this is a model without the sand, which will be put back after construction of these cells. And also, although it's the smallest project we did, I proved to be the most difficult one by now. And we're still working with contractor engineers to figure out what's the best way to do the formwork. What's important in this project is that how the space relate to the light, and every space have a different connection to the sunlight. And we work on with the possibility of the software to analyze and introduce light differently into different spaces. And working on the possibility of how to make a kind of device to catch the scent and the sound, you know, and the special wind around it and become part of the space. In this one of the largest cell where we is the main space for showing art and other functions, the skylights allow a certain time of the year the direct light on the floor, but it never hits the wall. And so that's it makes this very special shape of the light. In another kind of studio space where the light, the direct light never enters the space, and the space connecting different cells. So then we start testing how this can work. Although we have tried, I had a fantasies like how to make the form work. I thought about one idea can be ice. So we make frozen ice of the shape. And in the winter and the melts in the spring after we pour the concrete, but that was rejected by the contractor, said it's too hot. It was too hard, but it's possible actually, it could be a fantastic idea, but it's too hard to control that perfect timing. I can try that in a smaller scale. And then we thought about the 3D milling of, you know, the rigid form as the formwork. We even found out where to buy this 3D cutter from Alibaba. It's not so expensive, but again, rejected by the contractors. They still think it's too expensive, too complicated. They don't even read our drawings so well. Anyway, we thought about making sand. That was for a long time, the working drawing showing by layers of sand, also, you know, recommended by an engineer from Europe. That was also rejected by the contractor, said it's just too hard to control. But I think they are right, because when you use the vibrators, or after you pour the concrete, that can destroy, you know, any kind of formwork that's not rigid enough. So in the end, they've returned to the most conventional wood formwork and painstakingly cutting like strips of basically inch and a half. That's like lots of intensive labor, which I never thought they would do, but that's what they choose to do in the end. And that's what the markup. Of course, to convince the client to do this markup, which is, you know, quite complicated, I invent another project. I said, what if we make a swimming pool by the sea? That's gonna be the next project. So let's make a rock pool using the natural ocean water, which hasn't been one rock pool yet in China. And then we need a bathhouse or a changing room by the sea. So this mock-up won't be wasted. It will be the future changing room for the people come here for, you know, in the summer. So this mock-up just, this concrete pour happened about 2 weeks ago. And right before I left Beijing, they take out the formwork. And surprisingly, you know, if you remember the earlier renderings, it was all showing a kind of smooth surface because of how we imagine the formwork out of sand or foam to be relatively smooth with a plaster over it. But after I see this mock-up, I thought perhaps we change the design that just to show this texture of the real formwork. I don't know. I mean, I'm still working on it. But basically, this is what happened in the practice that this kind of accidental effects we never imagined happened in the process. But it happened with this great leader of the contractor, was an old gentleman who would retire, but was hired by this on this construction site, and he brought this kind of craftsmanship to the project. And I often learn a great deal from this men I respected, you know, from different projects that this bring surprises to the work. And then on the other side, as a dialogue, is another very special space for the art. In the opposite to the other organic, you know, cluster, collaborative space, this one will be about more about solidarity and is geometric, and is alone in the ocean, go about 150 meters into the ocean. So the very original idea is that to make a rock, make a piece of rock that just rising from underneath the ocean and become almost like just a part of the nature. Of course, what makes it feasible, possible, is that this part of the sea in China is very, very shallow. It goes out miles and miles, and even at 50 kilometers away from the shore, it's only 50 meters deep. So at this point, we're going 150 meters out. It's only 3 meters deep. But 3 meters deep, in the end, actually proved to be very difficult to construct because you can't bring the boat to do the pilings. And also at the time, China's building an island in the South China Sea. So they have called all the construction boat to the South China Sea to build islands. So we have no way to get any boat here. Plus it's too shallow. So, and this is actually much, much more difficult to build than any other thing I have imagined. And I'm working with engineers from different places, from London, from Beijing, trying to figure out a way to build, and still being discussed. Most feasible way to do this is probably we can build a temporary island with sand, with a shoring, and after the project is finished, you take off the shoring and the ocean wash the sands away, and here you come the building. I even had a fantasy in my mind how to build this building is to build it on the beach, build the whole thing on the beach, and then drag it to the ocean. And this idea works. I was even telling Steven about this concept last time we met. But the problem is, after you drag it to the ocean, there's no way to make sure it's leveled. So our engineer asked me, are you okay if the building is a little bit off? I said, no, not possible. So this is going to be a very abstract object in the ocean, which is sets a order, you know, in the true north, geometric relation to the earth. So I also present this project very differently. I thought, what if we present this project almost like an art exhibition? So we made 16 drawings on the square, you know, Hasselblad square format, Instagram format. And as I print them on the watercolor paper and pin up on the wall, do a little tiny little exhibition, and it's how we presented on the project, and was luckily immediately approved by the client with these 16 drawings. And those are the objects I collected from the site. And built entirely out of concrete, cast in place concrete. And with in black pigments. So it's like a black rock sitting in the sea and with a rough surface, and I hope the oyster will come back to you know, and to occupy the surfaces, so become really part of the nature. And that's how it sits in the ocean and set up a true north and south directions. And it's like a space for you to experience, I can put in a way that it's like a life of artists, perhaps, where you can, there's one tiny little cubic space for the artist studio, for artist residence, perhaps. And then this is the key of the space, it's a square, 6 meter by 6 meter room. It's just showing one art at a time, facing the ocean. And this is the idea. I hope to bring a new concept of how we see art today. And by the way, I just had the opportunity to make an even faster project last month for the Yulin Center in 798 in Beijing, taking this concept further to make, when I was asked by the gallery, the museum, to design the exhibition space for 23 artists. I had the concept to make one museum for each artist. So for this 4 months of the exhibition, we transformed the museum space into 23 small galleries. The idea really came from this project, that the gallery is also a space as a dialogue to the sea, you know, where the inspiration, which I am always fascinated by ocean, by the sea. And in the process of design, I discovered that there is a kind of the back of the space, we can take advantage of that, and perhaps at you know, at the high tides where you can't walk over through this kind of journey, that you can come by boat in this kind of secret place behind, where it has kind of strange quality of space and the light, and maybe there's also a way you can swim away from the space. And we make a very special opening on the top surface that allow light to come in to the space below throughout the year. But precisely at in the winter solstice, just a single moment of light, and maximize in the summer for 6 hours of that summer solstice. And in the rain will be collected and dripped through the hole. So in the space, you can also have a different kind of experience with nature. And this is a complex drawing showing how this special form of cuts in the concrete. So now I move to Shanghai. In the year 2013, we're invited to work on a project to in the west bund of Shanghai to rethink the future of these kind of oil tanks. That's where the site is. That's the center of Shanghai. That's the 2010 the World Expo. And this site, which used to be, well, that's now, but before 2002, this site used to be an abandoned airplane field, a very, very old airport, which actually was abandoned for probably half a century since the war. And Shanghai started to develop this part because it's a very large site, and with this, the city expands, it become part of the city. And right now is perhaps the most important development in the entire Shanghai. Part of the reason that art museum is a very important part of this site now, is leading the art scene in China, is that because the large amount of site they have to develop some commercial buildings that provide the funding for these art projects. And here's the site of the tank. Around it, and it was just recently announced. This is a museum by David Chipperfield. Centre Pompidou is going to have opened their first satellite campus here. And Sejima is working some, maybe their first skyscrapers here, and you know, Foster, et cetera, et cetera. And here is going to be a very crowded space for the Dream, what's called the Dream World Studio. So we're surrounded by this out of the business, and but the site is special because in the very early days, this part of the site has been planned as a urban park. And also it's kind of strange neighbor is a helicopter port, maybe the first in China. So this was the old days when it was used by was airport first built by the Japanese in before the World War II. We have, in the early research, where we trying to find out what has been done to oil tanks, and we realized there hasn't been any realized project about how to convert oil tanks. There's been lots of work being done on gas tanks and other tanks. But oil tanks are very interesting because it's made of purely out of thick steel plates, so its structure got this kind of super strong structure to resist this enormous pressure from a full tank of aviation fuel. But here's a story of the project that, in a way, is happening often where we work, that throughout the project, things change constantly. And that's the nature of maybe China today, that the speed of change and instability and constantly happening around you. This is when we first given the project that we were asked to look at this five tanks, there's four here, smaller one, a bigger one. And the original program we were called to work on is theaters, and mostly into theaters. But the other thing special about this work is that and actually I often enjoy to do is to program a project. I think that's perhaps the very interesting part of the nature of the practice that as an architect, you do have the opportunities to write a program. And we often volunteers to do that. Because there isn't any specialized firm who does programming for cultural project or public works, that often the program written in a kind of random way, and then you perhaps are building a mistake. So I think writing a good program is very important. So we work on, we first working with the city and then come up with the program to as the theaters, because that was the original idea. But through the process, because this powerful neighbor of the helicopter port, heliport, you know, they're part of the army, so they're very powerful, they start to change the site. And then we got another powerful neighbor with the Dream, what they call the DreamWorks Studio, also pushing the limits. So we're working with the not only the changing program, but also changing site. So you are commissioned to do one project, but you end up doing several projects because the things keep changing. But of course, you don't get paid for multiple projects. And as we're developing the theater and performing arts center programs, and later on, the client found out that they are making lots of theaters. Their DreamWorks studio making gigantic theaters, so there's no more need for more theaters on this site. And so they're looking for people who can run the space, and then here came this this powerful art collector who's one of the top three art collectors, and so they signed a contract with the client to run the space, so now we change to museums now, art museums, but to make to contemporary art work, which is, you know, in China, the public institutions not really funded by a sustainable funding, that a museum often doesn't really run very well. What you see, although China has probably built over 4,000 museums, I heard, in the past 10 years, but very few really function very well, because it's easy to make a building, but it's difficult to run a building, especially a museum doesn't really generate revenue as to support its operation. So we came up with working together with the new client programs that can support its operation. That so we're gonna have a live house, restaurants, and, you know, an event multifunctional space, in addition to some other kind of potentially commercial space to support this space for the art. And because the site is planned as a park, that literally no construction is allowed. So how to make it work still, although you can do anything within the tank, which doesn't really count, you know. So in the new politics in China, that you used to have a powerful leader who can just do whatever they want, but now as things start evolves, that even anybody at the planning department can reject the whole thing if it doesn't follow strictly the regulation. So we have to work with that regulation that no construction is allowed, or you don't get any square meters allowance for that. So we have to come up with a structure that qualifies or defined as a basement, which is okay. So making this what I call a super surface that connects the tanks and to make it functional instead of being totally independent. And it works out very well because it connects you from the street, you can walk up and to the other side where the site kind of naturally slope towards the river. So taking advantage of the height differences, and we start to develop this idea of this super surface connects them. And this urban forest, a very, you know, it's a massive urban forest, it's super natural, and making these two large urban plaza, you know, for different kind of events of the city. And that's basically the master plan today. The idea that to transform the content from oil to art and other civic life, and transform certain ways the shape for different use of space. So this is where different tanks, that three smaller ones, two large ones, two different functions inside. And we're keeping just the surface of the tank entirely intact, but by putting in different things inside. The live house with a bar below, and you know this, the club above, and the restaurants with a kind of cutout courtyards, which just help to make sure we're working with the overall square meters under the regulation. And one of the tank for showing art will keep it exactly the original condition to show kind of large artworks or installations. And the other one, by inserting multiple layers to turn that into a more conventional gallery space, and the other one making another layer inside, acoustic layer inside to make it work for performance. And this building also become kind of a stage for kind of outdoor performance, outdoor concerts. And that's the space we inserted under the green roof, start to connect all these things together and then provide the kind of back of house needed for the space. And that's the section. So every tank is transformed differently. And they're connected by this the roof above. As you can see, the sunken plaza come into the inside, and making the kind of steel plate ramps and stairs bring you up into the tank. And this shape, this kind of shape expands out, is also required by the structure to build to protect the original foundation of the tank, so it doesn't collapse during the construction or afterwards. I'll go into the other tank, and this is what the inside one of the empty tank for the art. The other more conventional one, and this is the space for performance or multiple event space. And then this is a special work we did, a competition we spent the longest time on for nearly 1 year working on one competition. And it's also the only project was not built out of all the eight I'm showing tonight, which is a pity. But we were very kind of honored to invite it to participate in this competition in one of the perhaps the most prominent site in Shanghai. It's a space they have kind of left intentionally empty for the the last 20 years of building this new Pudong area of Shanghai. And that's where the site is. It sits on the kind of interesting position of the past. This is a photograph from the 1930s, from the kind of horse racing field. And this is how the city has evolved. This is probably a photograph taken from the 1960s to a recent time. I call that a postcard city, because the city really about making this image, but it's also represent the, for a long time, is as showing the as a symbol of the development of China today. But what's happening really on the ground is a different story. It's a city, it represents a typical Chinese cities, new cities, where it's more about making image, less about urban life and the personal experience. And perhaps this opportunity, to me, is more about building a museum, but rather to rethink how we can deal with the city today. So I thought about a different kind of urbanism or a naturalism and humanistic one can help to relink this kind of fragmented cities together. And that's where the site is. And so we propose to rebuild the riverbank into a new kind of urban park. And also rebuild this kind of abandoned, fragmented space underneath the TV tower, and then connect them with another park. So then the museum, what kind of museum should it be? Somebody sitting in this kind of interesting and important connection. It should not be just another object which we've been building for too long. Maybe it's something new that is something that bridge art and the nature. So here comes the concept that we can work out a possibility of building that is both a park and a museum, and program a museum differently, that away from the conventional museum spaces, which is often another kind of image, but here it invites people to come in and being the activities of the urban life and the activity of the nature become part of the museum experience. Here you can see the solid space of the art space, and the open space in between is where the social functions and the parks come in, and you can actually visit and this museum in the other spaces more than the museum hours, and some spaces open 24 hours a day, the park being completely part of the park. And this is showing some different unexpected moments of how the nature and art can kind of come together, and sitting in the library. So the attempt is just to rethink what a public institution can be and what a urban architecture can be at this time of the history. Unfortunately, the conservative jury picked another object from a one of the Pritzker winner. Up to today, they still did not announce publicly who's the winner. Although I think they're going to build it, unfortunately. Move to further south. come to the Pearl River Delta region. This is Hong Kong. This is Shenzhen and the Guangdong and Canton. I just noticed afterwards that the three projects we did here happened to be all next to a new train station they built. This a bullet train station. So there was a moment of overlap with the project I was working on, the construction site here, and also this is under construction. I can go from this site to another construction site in less than 20 minutes. Amazing, because it was otherwise it would take you the whole day to travel, but the bullet train takes only 20 minutes to go from one site to another site. HEX-SYS, the interest of mass customization begins with when we first founded the open architecture. That's, of course, the part of the name is about that when we were asked by one of the biggest developers in China, Vanke, to design a showroom for them, that's where the project sits now. It's a tiny, tiny project of 600 square meters next to this monster train station. For one of their biggest real estate projects in the city. As you can see, this is the map of 2016. But only a few years ago, in 2010, and in 2008, it's still just rice farms and complete countryside. But you can see the train station is being built. You know, the foundations are done. And then in 2006, 10 years ago, there was nothing here, literally. So that's why we inherited the site. Basically, it's a blank site, but soon gonna be something like this. And the site, what we sit on, this pavilion we're gonna build as a showroom, will be there just for a few years. And that's a very common typology in China, where there are temporary buildings being built everywhere as a showroom for real estate developers. And for a while, that this kind of sales pavilions or showrooms are the rare opportunities for architects to experiment, you know, so it become kind of experimental opportunities. Things being built, you know, building all crazy shapes, but all torn down in a short 2 years, sometimes even 6 months. And so I thought, can this be done differently, you know? With inspiration from architect Loco Brazier or Jean Prouvé in their early, they're probably lifelong experiment into different kind of building systems, and taking the inspiration from nature, you know, the structure behind nature, and this very inspiring work by Steven Wolfram, who claimed he discovered the secret behind everything in the world. And it's a book I bought when it first came out. So we come with this kind of building system that from a singular module of 40 square meters, this is a 4 meter on the edge, a typical hexagon. I take on an inverted kind of cone shape or funnel shape with one single column, and it never works with a single unit. You have to work as a group. So the idea is that this column and this beam are working together in a way as a coherent structure, or almost like an arc. And the inverted cone with this single column also function as the rain pipe. So it supports the building, also collects the rainwater. But then it can be reconfigured in different ways. And this, in fact, is actually our working tool to work with the client to figure out the program and the distribution, the layout of the programs. And we made this kind of We made this kind of IKEA type diagram to show how the pieces work together. And the contractor who won the bid has this gigantic factory in Hangzhou. And so we requested that we let's first experiment with a prototype built full scale in the factory. This in this markup allow us time to test the different details and connections. And this building perhaps is by far the most precise construction we ever did, because everything was controlled, fabricated in the shop, in the factory, and put together. And then later on they move all the pieces on the truck, bring down from Hangzhou to Guangzhou over quite a long distance. And this shows the sequence of how the things works. To make it reusable, everything has to be reusable, including the floor, so things come into a different kind of modules of concrete and steel, and everything is kind of bolted instead of welded together, where, you know, typical, the Chinese country like to weld everything. They use the welding thing as a glue. People like to just weld everything together, it's easier. But here they have to, you know, face different challenge. Everything is kind of come together with kind of bolt connection. And that's the rain pipe, also the structure. And the facade come in also in this 1 meter by 4 meter module. It was put up quickly in less than a month on the site. And the ceiling has this gap to allow the lighting and the other infrastructure to go. And my favorite space of this project is this kind of empty, the void, the one that's missing unit that is a little kind of Zen garden. And the special details allows the water to drain around this the steel structure to go into the pond. Next project is it's a competition. Oh, my neck is twisted. This competition we won in 2014 for a new cultural complex. So we work as three architects working together for this kind of team competition. And after that, each one got to pick one project to develop. So I picked the theater because I haven't done opera house before. So I said, let's work on the opera house. The most technically challenging work ever so far in terms of design, because just the density of things happening there. But what's interesting about this project, again, 2007, 2017, over the 10 years time, this project's in the outer part of Shenzhen, where they are building a new district, heavily populated with factories, like one of the largest electric car factories, all kind of happening around here. So a new city is being built, and this strip of opera house, museums, and the libraries are the center of the town as a kind of cultural works. So when we began the projects, we did the research about theaters in China being built. Over the last 10, 15 or 20 years, China has built a lot of theaters, concert halls, opera house, in just about every major or non-major cities. Every city has a theater, but most of the theater happening, you know, in this kind of different shapes, but with a kind of conventional form inside. But what's happening as we check the status of the theaters, that most of the theaters heavily relies on the subsidies of the government to just support the survival. Because, you know, in a way, opera house, operas, it's not really part of the Chinese culture at the moment, that the rarely has any program to show. So to sustain the operation is super expensive, and often is the space is closed for a long time. In as a interesting joke, that in Tianjin there's a giant opera house, and one day, one winter, they had this ballet company from Russia to have a ballet show. And at the time, the day of the performance, they have to cancel the show because the space is too cold. And the reason it's too cold because there's no performance for the last few months. So to turn on the air conditioning, it takes days to heat up the space. So that's just the reality of the space. So we thought we really have to reinvent the program, and by adding some of the commercial space to generate revenue and to put out the public programs to make it more open to the public to use building instead of having it empty. And then adding a black box, which is much, much more feasible and easier to use than this kind of giant 1,500 seats auditorium. And then bring the different gardens in a kind of tropical climate. So within the same budget, after months and months of working with this, with back then it has a very liberal leader of the new district, they were able to accept this new proposal to rewrite the program into something else, more richer than what they begin with, just a 1,500 seats opera house. And I guess I was thinking to do something different from the other object making theater. Let's return to a very simple shape of the box. So let's put all this kind of dramatic life things happening in the box. But what's different than most of the other opera house or theaters in China, that it will have a vibrant urban life and art activities around it instead of having just empty box inside. So that's the space now, the black box. And then this is the journey takes you around, wrapping around, has the theater space for the public, and taking you to different other kind of public spaces, and to the roof, different kind of gardens. And the building just top up recently. Maybe takes another 6 months or maybe a year to get it done. But here you can see how the other kind of public space wrapping around this, the theater space. The last project, it's a project we just finished recently, but it took 5 years to design and build. Again, I remember when we first got the project, we were required to get the project done in 2 years, I remember, but it turns out to be 5 years, which is luckily gave us a lot more time to develop details and rethink lots of things we couldn't think through. But so this project's for Tsinghua University and happening in this a college town. And we found out in China has built more than 80 college town in the past few years, that college town in a way is just a small but example of instant cities, you know, the city being built and designed and built nearly overnight. And so this campus was built and designed and built in only a few years' time. And as a typical problem of this kind of new cities, that it lacks its pleasant urban life. You know, I noticed very few people walking on the campus because there isn't that much kind of support function you can use. I also noticed that in this kind of space designed for research lab who doesn't understand how the lab works, that in scientific research, the labs often had to be reconfigured in a short 5 years' time, sometime when the scientists move on to different research topic, but the building doesn't, it's not adaptive to that. So you see this existing campus have all these professors adding on their own mechanical shaft, everything on the outside, making space inside full of kind of toxic fumes. And then, so the original campus has this kind of axis and connecting different teaching buildings and the dormitories. And the building we're designing happened to be set on the very end of the axis. And also as the very last building to be built on this site. And this provides the opportunity for us to make something that can and provide what this campus is missing, you know. Taking the notion of a more kind of friendly campus quad structure and make it vertical into a vertical campus. By making, kind of carving this gap between the different offices and the labs, it brings nature and the public life into it and provide a space for, you know, people to meet and what they call a humanist approach. And also, by putting the shaft and mechanical support on the two ends, it allows a future, you know, reconfiguration of the labs. Also, we have intentionally lots of actual shaft space for them to putting on different kind of equipments in the future. And this shows on different levels we are, you know, introducing different, you know, the cafeterias and exhibition space, shops, and the space where we have this open air. By making certain program onto this kind of level of the open air, it also saves the energy because this will be air conditioned free in with the kind of cross ventilation. This project, we have to face a out of all the eight I've been showing tonight, is the lowest budget on around $80 a square foot, I calculated, $80 a square foot. So we have nothing else but the structure, so which is make it a simple strategy that would let's try to make something completely out of concrete, because that's the only thing we left. So there's nothing additional as possible here. So this building is literally built out of completely out of concrete. The shading is also prefab extruded concrete, cement, and that's the contractor building this formwork of the skylights. Amazing way of making this happen. I'd like to keep. we have a project there on station on site to follow through the construction. I asked him to tell everyone to not to screw around with the concrete, to keep the original texture. So one day he called me, he said he went out for lunch, and when he came back from lunch, the contractor started to put a plaster over this concrete, and they considered it not perfect. So every time I came to the site to visit, I bought this sander, so I sent this, little by little, sent off the plaster they put over this concrete. So now finally you can see the not perfect concrete again. And this, the students found this wall is perfect for practice tennis, and because this is really, I guess he found a bit of personal freedom here, finally there's something you can play with on the campus. On the roof, we made this kind of little tiny little amphitheater to watch the city. And the city has changed so much since we worked on the project for the last 5 years. I must say it's less beautiful than before. That's the very deep testing pool underground, which this building has a 20 meter deep basement. By building this expensive basement, it, already use up half the budget. So we have only $40 square foot for the buildings above. And this shading works very effectively. You know, the building sits on the kind of luckily 45 degree orientation. By putting this on the, on, you know, the southeast and northwest facade, it shades building very effectively that we can are able to use just a single pane glass by calculation and still keep it thermal performance well enough. And there's some kind of strange moment. And then this, it's not really about the giraffe looking at the buildings, but more about that this building, which is called the outdoor space, allows this professor who just normally sit in their room all the time, drinking their own coffee, they don't even share coffee machines, that have the opportunity to look at nature, look at this giraffe from, you know, their space in the building. We're often questioned in China that there's always, we have a client coming to us saying, your building don't look Chinese. So what's your, do you have anything Chinese in the design? Of course, our building don't look Chinese as some others do. But in the very early time of my study, the two things has always influenced me very deeply. On the left side, that how the buildings works as a way it frames spaces instead of being an object. On the right side is a book about making buildings, or almost like an instruction of making buildings dated back in the Song Dynasty, that in a way it really allows buildings to happen in China without architects, that things are already pre-described in a very systematic way, from how the structure works in the modular ways and down to various details. So I think this systematic thinking and how the role architecture plays in making spaces has often always deeply influenced my thinking about architecture, among others. And then borrow the word from Le Corbusier, object of poetic reaction. We make our first book, Open Reaction, Architecture of Poetic, Perhaps Radical Reaction. I'm going to end my lecture with this sentence. Project Open is an ongoing investigation through practice and research on the power of architecture to reorganize the relationships between oneself and his spiritual being, one with others, and with nature around us. Thank you very much. Sorry, it took too long.
So I have to start with a story because Lee worked, we worked together for 10 years. And my first project in China, we were invited by Isasaki to do a museum in Nanjing. And we're in Nanjing. It was a nice, you know, kind of cultural project. It took us 12 years to build it. By the way, everything we do takes much longer than what you do. It's amazing. Our projects take 8 years. From the first sketch until the building. Anyway, that was something, that's another topic about speed and time. But we were together and you got an email that said they wanted us to come to Beijing to do 8 towers, like 30 stories tall. They wanted us to, you know, kind of redesign it or something like that. And I said, that can't be true. Tell them they have to send us a ticket, you know, business class ticket from Nanjing to Beijing, okay. So he did. They sent us a ticket. We went to Beijing. They picked us up at the airport in a white Mercedes. They took us to the Beijing hotel. They paid for our hotel in $5,000 in cash, in American dollars. The next morning we went, and at the office, there was a poster on the outside of the building that said, "Welcome, Steven Holl and his partner at Li Yu." And so I said, "Well, you know, they might be real." And then, so they wanted us to save this industrial building and, you know, put a new skin on a planning diagram of eight towers. Basically, they wanted facades and they wanted a name. And I said, "Look, this site in the middle of Beijing is so important." So I convinced them to give us 3 months and $300,000 to do a totally idealistic scene.
Right.
Then we went back to you were in the office, right? We went back to the office and we started to try to use the building that they wanted and for a while, and we said, "Shh, this is terrible." So then we decided we're going to make such an idealistic scheme. It would be like a utopian scheme. We're going to take away the sheds and all the crap that they wanted. You know, it was really an industrial building. They wanted to put an art museum or something. So we were going to make a pond. We put a cinematheque. We connected all the buildings with bridges. And it was a completely utopian scheme. And the main client didn't come to the opening, I mean to the presentation in New York. But Lee and I presented it to like 10 people that flew from Beijing. And they stood there in silence, like staring at what we had done, you know, like, they wouldn't say anything. And I thought, no way, you know, this is like, okay, we did it, we had our beautiful thing, I can put it in the Museum of Modern Art or whatever, you know, it's great. And then like 2 weeks later, they sent an email, they said, "Your project greatly exceeds our budget. However, we're gonna raise our budget to build your project. Don't take anything out." Which blew me away. I mean, that's the linked hybrid project, we wrote the program together, right? We had to rewrite the whole program. But I would just say that was the moment of China in the year 2002 to 2008 before the Olympics, which was an unbelievable moment to be in China and to be working. And that's how we started together. And it was incredible. I mean, they really would do it. After the Olympics, it sort of went down, right? It changed. But I think what's amazing is the work you're doing, you're carrying on that idealism. I thought, especially for me, the first project has all these dimensions that we were working on in the beginning. You know, the sense of the fact that it's a school, I mean, that brachiating form is a little bit some of the things that we were trying to do with the horizontal skyscraper, but forming gardens. I think that the fact that you achieved all these spaces in such a kind of, you know, that was also a short project, right? It was what?
Design.
3 years, 2 years.
Well, it took 4 years to build, but the initial design was a competition. So we had the idea, we had to work out a scheme in 2 months.
Right.
And we worked, I remember, we first had 30 schemes. And then we chose the one I thought probably the most promising.
Right. I think it's a beautiful project. I mean, I'm going to be a critic like a professor. Is that okay?
Oh, yeah. I expect
so I'm going to, like, I'm going to tell you the projects that are great and the ones that are not. Okay. Is that all right?
Oh, yeah.
Are my students here? I think the first project is absolutely amazing. It's fantastic almost in every way, and especially in the social way. The second one, also, the way the courtyard theater, you know, the way the theater opens to the courtyard. I mean, the idea of trying to make a diagram that had to be just the site, I think that was a way to start. That's the way we did a project recently as well. I mean, sometimes you have to make a quick start. It was a smart start. But the fact that you could realize this courtyard connecting to the theater is amazing. I think it's an amazing project. The dialogue with the sea, fantastic. You know, it's all about idealism. Villa Malaparte is there for sure, right? You admit Villa Malaparte is in there, right? It's in there. I mean, I think then I start to lose it. I'm sorry. I mean, I get to the oil tanks, and I think the problem with architecture is if you're given a problem, it may be a specious problem. And that, I would have to say that structure is 20% of a project if they say they want you to use all those oil tanks, but then what you end up with formally is a compromise, you know, that you would have to say that saving the oil tanks, was it really worth it? I remember the project that Wolf Pricks did in Vienna. Do anybody know that oil tank project outside of Vienna? It's not his best project, you know, and it's a problem because, first of all, you're given something you might have to try to reject. I don't know, that's my... museum in the park, Shanghai, I think this concept is great, right? But why wasn't it more like the diagram? I would say that that could have been something more like the diagram. Instead, it went to just sections and shapes that are, you know, in a way rigid, right? I mean, look, you presented something so beautiful and poetic with this dialogue with the sea, and then right afterwards, you just box it up with us, right? I mean, how about that? I mean, what do you think about the between those two?
Well, I try to discover, you know, the potential of every project. Every project has offered different opportunities. And in the dialogue by the sea, it's really trying to establish a deep connection to the sand, to the water. In the case of Shanghai, I am trying to work out I don't know what you have problem with the boxes, but I'm trying to establish a simple relationship between the art, space of the art, and the rest of the social and the
right. But the concept space. You showed the concept as a diagram of these two hands,
yes,
which is a beautiful diagram,
and fingers.
All right, but I mean, in a certain sense, look, everything is rounded here. I mean, in a certain sense, the building kind of ignores the diagram. In other words, it doesn't really follow the conceptual diagram. I would say it's.
I don't know. Maybe.
Couldn't it be more
fluid shape?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it just seemed to be. Okay, and then. Let me finish. You got eight projects, man. I'm gonna. Let me finish. Okay.
All right. Okay.
Because I want to just summarize.
Sure.
I think that the sixth project, Nesting Hexagons, is too much Walter Nesch. It's like a 1970s field theory project, but it's beautifully executed. So, like, when I look at the idea in the beginning of it, I thought, ah, come on, this is done by Moshe Safdie, Walter Nesch. But what I really loved about it is how beautifully it's built, and it was quickly done. So that won me over when you realize it so well. But in the beginning, I would have said, try something else.
All right.
And then the vertical campus, I thought, was a beautiful project. And that was a project that was started at the same moment of the first one, right, the school. So to me, is I would say, if I was going to be your professor criticizing you after only 7 years of an office, right? You're only 7 years old, right? Mm-hmm. I made a diagram of all the offices. I didn't put it up because it was too selfish. That started from SHA. And by the way, they're out here. There's Tim Bade. There's Martin Cox. And then I think somebody from ARO is here. And I was so proud, by the way, to have 9 offices around the world that people were more than 3 years in SHA, and they're doing great work. All of them, you know, and I felt very, very proud about that. So I was very happy to be here tonight to be your critic. So I think if I was going to summarize, I would say that the vertical campus building has all this idealism that the very first building does, the school, garden, farm, as does the dialogue with the sea. And if I were to make the lecture, I would just present those three and then try to say what your theory is. Because I worry that today, you know, the problem with practicing as an architect today is people are not really, you know, forced to come up with a theory. They're basically, the value system was sort of started by OMA, and that is bigness. That is, build the biggest office. I think that's not really a value system that we should hold. I like Alvar Cisse's idea that he once he had a little bit too much work, he would give it to Sultan de Moreau or you know, kind of branch it off. And I think that, to me, is a better strategy than trying to have a huge office. So I wonder, in your future, are you trying to have an office of 150 people or 200?
No. That's for sure. I mean, I remember you were saying that when I first started the office, you said, oh, the ideal size is a football team.
Right, 11.
Right. Well, you got bigger now.
Well, we had one project that took a lot.
You have three football team now, right? I have two.
Yeah, but
so we're two football
like
team. But
it's not.
Anyway, but I think it's very important that you are working on every single detail of every single project. That's very important. I'm equally suspicious of any operation that move beyond that and has become a different kind of operation. I wouldn't call it commercial, but it is a new concept now, you know.
This is a value system that, you know, that I don't agree with, and I think it was started, I'm sorry, with OMA, and it's a kind of the idea that, you know, just say yes, and the idea that you make a bigger and bigger office. You can't really do the details when you do that.
Yeah.
You can't do, that hexagonal project, it comes alive in the details. It's incredible where the troughs of the, feel like Carlos Scarpa is there, right? And I think that architecture is experienced that way. It's important that when we go to a building, we touch the handle of the door, we see the light, and I sense that's in some of your work. I just hope you would hold on that line and give up on the 200 person office idea of what's the goal, you know? I mean, what's the goal of architecture?
Well, that's never the concept. I mean, the I think there's a belief I will never give up, and I always believe in the, you mentioned Carlos Gaba, but details and experience part of the human experience, you know, I trying to emphasize what I'm looking for is what can you use architecture to express the kind of human spirit, which I felt that this in this chaotic world today is really missing. You know, do you think are we better off than the ancient Greek time? Not really. In the humanistic level, not really. We're highly advanced in the technology and the material life, but not the other way around. So don't worry about that. I'm going to
go. No, but I liked the beginning of. I really did like the beginning of the talk where scale, time, knowledge, reality, greed, future, speed, power, freedom, bubble, all of these things that we all need to think about as architects. That's in the foreground, and I think that all of us need to keep those things in the foreground. Personally, I don't think it would be better in Greek times where, you know, you don't have electricity, you don't have toilet. I mean, New York City was full of horse shit. It was really smelly in 1850. You know, there was no electricity. I think that we live in times that could be, by architects and great design and ecological buildings, could be fantastic. I think our project at Beijing Linked Hybrid is an example. 660 geothermal wells that heat and cool the project. It completely works today. You were there when we did the visit after 8 years. It's completely working with recycled water. So it was about forming urban space and not forming an object. I mean, it's full of idealism. It exists as an example that it can be denser. We don't have to go back to sort of the 19th century. I think, in fact, I'm very excited about the fact that those potentials exist. I just hope you get the clients that can let you do it. I mean, I think it's fantastic. I mean, the scariest, maybe the scariest slide in the show was that very idealistic first project and then what happened around it, how all those buildings were built around it in the same time that you did the project, right? In 5 years or something.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I agree with you. The moment before Olympics and after it certainly is different in many levels. Before Olympics, you know, the developers are working with reality that the price goes up every single day. So they have literally no worries. It's a time of risk taking. Today is a different place. You know, the mentality is going more conservative. Less willing to take a risk, which I don't blame them.
What about this ocean project? What's this guy's not more conservative? That's pretty amazing.
Yes, so the opportunities still exist with certain, even there are rare species of client who still looking for idealistic things, and that's why we filter through them. Like as mentioned, I turned down at least 50 commissions of schools. I said no to those, because I don't believe they offer opportunity to make a good architecture.
I tried to say no to linked hybrid. Thank you for not So anyway, do we have some questions? Question there?
Hi, Li Hu is an old friend, but I have to confess, first of all, I'm not an architect or anything. I'm a political scientist, but I've been following Li Hu's work since we got to know each other in 2008. I want to recall an actual similar conference at Tsinghua Architecture School. We were as a social scientist, I was very interested, I'm still very interested in the social impact of buildings. I remember I commented on your project with Steven Holl, actually, the Beijing project. I was so impressed by the kind of philosophy really reflected in your name of your firm is openness and the connectiveness beyond the, you know, the environmental, ecological kind of the innovation. So I think in the last, now almost 10 years, I see your projects, that philosophy of openness and connectedness, if I to use two words to summarize your design philosophy, seems to be there, still there. But my question is, this is related to what Steven Holl commented about, you know, 2008, before 2008, things seem to be a lot, you know, risk-taking, a lot of, you know, openness. Now, there seems to be a lot of pull to pull back, if I use a philosophy, you know, sort of a philosophical point, is the authorities, the clients, the society that forces you, you want to open up, you want to reach out, connect, the connect between human and nature and human. I'm also very interested in that. You know, take your example of that schoolyards, with that school design. You have a lot of open space throughout all your 8 projects. And then you also, in passing, you mentioned something about when air is polluted, the kids have to come in. So that's another kind of pulling sort of inwardness, that pulling. So how do you reconcile this sort of the pull of you want to open? You know, just like politically now, where everybody kind of now going backward, inwardly. So how do you philosophically and as a practice, how do you sort of fight back and reconcile that?
Well, that's a very good question. And you touch upon many topics. The first, is China going more conservative today? Yes, for sure. New York City? Yes, for sure. I think in the late 90s, a different city here. Maybe it's going more conservative globally. As in China, in our practice, we have lost any public commission since or opportunity to do real public work for many years. Our last project that is a purely public work is still the theater in Shenzhen. And, you know, because of this, they were still having that strong and powerful planning department who were willing to intervene into the operations. But that's lost with the new political system. People don't want to make any mistakes, any suspicion of that. And literally, all the public works are now managed by bidding companies. You know, they confuse architect with contractors. Everything goes through a bidding, which actually allows even more corruption to happen. So since that, I mean, I was so disappointed by the many opportunities. I said, we're not going to be doing any more public works for now, which is true. Things are going more conservative, so we have to seek in a different way. If we're still making efforts to make some kind of social contribution, we have to look for different opportunities. You know, I mean, I'm so jealous of Steven working on this amazing public works commission all around the world. Yeah, I don't. When I have an opportunity to work with this oil tank, yes, it's not ideal. I have to make it work.
No, but maybe it's not.
But wait, when it's built, I think it will be amazing. But you have to just make something out of the not so ideal scenario. You know, back to your second question about being open. We face lots of resistance, like the vertical campus project. Yeah. It was a fight all the way through. You know, when
the professors, the Tsinghua professor, you know, no, Professor Lu, no, Tsinghua professors are so conservative and so, in a way, selfish, claustrophobic. When they see the open space we create, the first thing they said is, can I close it off? I need more space. You know, everything's coming out of the kind of real estate idea. I want more space. So I'm like working in fear all the time. I'm trying to find different strategy to save something, you know. It's been very difficult.
But like Spinoza said, good things are never easy. That's true. As difficult as they are rare.
That's so, the thing, precisely, but, I have to constantly telling my team right. in the office.
And I would say so to hard. All students, don't take the message of the negativity that things are difficult. Think about this is a moment to contemplate and to reestablish what our principles are. Yes. You know, the definition of theory comes from the Greek word theoria, is contemplation, a set of principles on which the practice of an activity is based. And then there's another definition. A theory is a set of organized principles that explain and guide analysis. One of the ways theory is defined is that it is different from practice. And my position is that we talk too much about practice, because here we are at a university. It should be about what are the, you know, the idealistic things. And that's why I like the first project and the last project, because they, in a way, they start with these super idealistic positions and you realize them. But I'm actually interested in the first part of your lecture and how that could be developed in your book. Time, knowledge, reality, greed, future, speed, power, freedom, bubble. I think these are the principles. You know, in a way, I like Lu Kong's statement, architecture doesn't exist. You know, that what exists is the idea of architecture. And as a university and as a place, we're not really interested in practice. We're interested in what the idea, we can all go out and practice afterwards. But here, it's about ideas.
Of course.
Yeah. Right, Juan? He runs second year. Anyway.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.